Okay, we're ready to start our last regularly scheduled Thursday seminar this semester. So we'll start back up after TRB week in January. There is a lecture on Monday. A gentleman from Sweden, I forget his name.
Matt something.
Oh, yeah, Matt's.
Wendell?
Wendell. Yeah. And he'll be speaking, because he's in town, I think, by two of this conference. But today we'll have a PhD student speak, Hussein Bowler. He's been here, actually didn't put what year you came here. What year did you?
2010, summer.
Yeah, 2010. It looked like 2008, but I was like, that's a long time for a master's. And he's been working on railroad track infrastructure, granular materials, and he'll speak today about chemically bound ballast aggregate layers. So we look forward to hearing.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for having me here today. I'm going to talk about shear strength behavior of chemically bonded aggregates today. And this was my master's study. I will briefly introduce the railroad track. Then I'm going to talk about polyurethane stabilization, why we do it, and which material we are using. I'm going to talk about our direct shear testing methodology. And later, I'm going to pass through more column failure envelopes, especially their nonlinear nature. I'm going to present some results. In order to interpret some of the results, we had to run some discrete element modeling analysis, and I'm going to talk about those too. And later, I'm going to pass through the, what we are going to do in the future and what we are planning. So this is. This sketch is the conventional ballasted railroad track. There are, you can see in North America, there are four components of the railroad track: rail, tie, ballast, and subgrade. The main part we are interested in is ballast in this presentation. There are two functions of ballast layer. One of them is the distribution of the axle loads coming from trains. The other is the drainage. Drainage is very important for us for railroad aggregates. For that reason, we usually use uniform gradation or open gradation for ballast layer. Why we are using polyurethane? Shear strength is very important for ballast layer because as the heavy axle loads applied through to ballast, they tend to laterally displace. So in some problematic railroad track positions, this is becoming a real problem, even causing some derailments due to settlements. So in order to increase the shear strength, the BSF produce a polymer material, polyurethane material that increase the shear strength via bonding. This is the polyurethane we use. It has two components. It is called elastotrack, and the mixing ratio is resin equals 1.4 isocyanate. I'm going to talk about direct shear testing. This is the ballast aggregates we tested. We tested two types of ballast, which are granite and limestone. And those were the gradations we used. You can see they are uniformly graded. This is the sample box sizes we used during our test. It has two components. The bottom box is 14 inch length, 12 inch wide, and 6 inch deep. And the upper ring, the second component over there, is a 12 inch square and have a 3 inch height. This is how we prepared our sample. First, we mix 3% by weight of polyurethane with our ballast aggregates, and we mix them until all the surfaces get coated. We place two lifts and compact the bottom box, compact each lift with a compaction plate and also this dynamic compactor, and also place the upper ring and place the last lift and compact to get this final shape. We also tested unbound aggregates to compare the results. The process is same, but we just use non-coated aggregates. This is our direct shear testing device. fuel. We apply pressure, normal pressure with air. This is where air membrane plays, and we transmit the air with an air hose to that air membrane. This over there is, there is a pressure cell at the top of there, reads the normal force, and as during testing, this pressure cell reads the shear force, and it has a capacity to move 4 inches. This is another look at the process of the testing. We basically place the this pressure cell of the upper ring, and we move that button box over that direction with a 0.48 inches per minute speed, and we collect the shear force and also the up the pressure cell at the up collect the normal force so that we can get the shear stress, maximum peak stress during testing. We targeted three normal pressures, 15, 25, and 35. And as I said, it is strain controlled. And I'm gonna talk about Morcolin failure envelopes and their nonlinear nature. This is the famous Morcolin failure envelope we know, and there is also the Columbus equation, tau max equals C plus sigma multiplied by tangent phi. C in here is apparent cohesion intercept, sigma is normal stress, and tau max is the shear strength. In the if we test non-cohesive soil, C must be zero, right? But there will be always some mathematical error due to non-linearity of this envelope that creates some mathematical cohesion intercept. That is the reason why we call it apparent cohesion intercept. As I said, it is not linear, but theoretically it should be linear. But why it is linear is we have two kind of bond between aggregates. One of them is the physical bonds, the other is the chemical bond. In this first situation, when you increase your force between particles, normal force between particles, your shear force to apart them should increase too, right? So as you increase your, but in the second case, when you have a chemical bond between them, you will have a higher shear force to increase them because there is a chemical bond exists between them. However, when you continue to increase in the normal force, this chemical bond starts to degrade. So your chemical bond will be weaker to contain this, to resist the shear force, but your physical force continue to increase. In summary, as your normal stress increases, your physical bond between particles will increase too. However, your chemical bond between particles degrade. And the physical bond between particles will not be, physical, and the thing is, physical, even the increases of the physical strength between the particles will not be linear. I mean, if you have a 30 psi shear strength at 15 psi confining pressure, you will not get a 60 psi shear strength at a 30 psi confining pressure. You will get less shear strength at 35 confining pressure. This is our results. Before beginning, I like to highlight something. These dashed lines are granite results, and this straight lines is limestone results. In unbound condition, in this, if you look at these two lines, we had higher shear strength for granite than limestone, but when we chemically bond them with polyurethane, we had much higher strength for limestone than granite. For now, just keep that one in mind.
Can you explain which ones are bound and unbound?
Those two lines are unbound, the others are bound. So granite is this line. This is the limestone for unbound condition, and those are the granite for bound condition. But the main reason I'm showing that plot is If you look at that table, the values of that table, we are having some cohesion intercept for even unbound conditions. And this basically must be zero, right? It is basically a mathematical error that caused due to the linear nature of this Moore-Cohen-Filler envelope. But in this case, if you look at the cohesion intercept of the bound condition, are they really our cohesion intercepts? How many of them is apparent, I mean, the mathematical error, how many of them is the cohesion intercept? So, you know, we decided to show the results with normalizing the shear stress with the normal stress, as can be seen in this plot. As you see, if you increase the normal stress, your shear stress ratio, I mean the tau max over sigma n, will decrease too. And this is going to be very clear in bound conditions rather than unbound conditions, because in unbound conditions, you only have a physical stress that doesn't increase linearly. But in chemically bounded condition, even your physical strength will increase, your chemical bond will degrade, causing this decreases in the ratios. And again, for 3 days, again, as I highlighted, in granite, we had less strength for limestone in unbound condition, but in bound condition, but the granite's strength for unbound condition was slightly higher than limestone. So why this is happening?
Can you go back to explain those three figures you showed? Because I don't think you're emphasizing enough about how are those decreases happening in the bond versus unbond, right? The ones that are coming from a higher level down, a much greater decrease is happening with which one?
Yes. The inbound condition, we are having much...
I think you should highlight that. That's
the main point. Okay. If you look at the bound conditions, just these two lines, you see a much decrease in that condition, much decrease than these two lines. Ideally, these two lines, there are unbound test results. These two lines should be straight, but they are decreasing, which causes cohesion intercept, an apparent cohesion intercept. The reason why we are even having more decrease for bound condition is our physical strength between particles are increasing, but our chemical bond is degrading. That causes that decrease in the ratios. Now, why this is happening? If you look at the gradations with a different perspective, those are the percent retained between different sizes. You see in granite particles are larger than limestone, right? So in a sample, there is more granite particles that created more contact points, that created more chemical bonds. But in limestone, in granite, there were less more particles created less contact points. But in limestone, we are having the reverse condition. There are more particles, there are more contact points that creates more chemical bonds that cause an increase in the shear strength that why we get these results like that. But how we can prove that? If we look at that plane, this is the shear plane after we tested, you can see the chemical bonds, at the contact points. This is how what we are trying to calculate. But in real life, we should be able to see that with density, right? With porosity. Porosity is, for reminder, is the voids of the volume, volume of the voids over the total volume. In our test, limestone density was around 39.5% for porosity, and granite was around 41.2%. So there is not that much difference that we can gather information and understand what's going on. So what we did, we ran some discrete element modeling simulations to understand what was really going on. And I used that particles from Dr. Huang's study. Those are the main particle shape we used. And I created two libraries which had low angularity and high flattened elongated particles, and also high angularity and low flattened elongated particles. And with using that library, we simulated both of the gradations for both limestone and granite. And there were three replicates for each. And this is how we run our simulations. Basically, we start creating the particles. We drop them on the floor. We apply a compression to compact particles. Then we dilated the particles until we get a height of 9 inches. Then we apply the compaction plate again and apply pressure. In that last step, now since the number of contact objects identified in discrete element modeling is counted, we can divide them with the number of the cycles and get an estimate of how many number of contacts we created during the simulation. And this is what we got. If you look at the, I mean, first of all, there was not a lot of difference between using high angular particles and low angular particles in case of the number of contacts created. But if you look at the porosity or relative density, we see they are almost equal. They are differ between 40.8% to 43.8%. Only 3% when using, I mean, in case of low angular granite, there's the worst case is high angular granite is 43.8% and low angular limestone is 40.8%. But when you look at the number of contacts varied, there is almost a 50% difference between limestone and granite number of contacts. So idea is, I guess we can prove it that we were having more number of contacts during testing, which caused more chemical bonds, increased the shear strain. In future, what we are planning to do, those are all ARMA recommended gradations. We are planning to create a lot of gradations that matches with that gradation requirements and simulate them to see what's going on. And hopefully get an equation to estimate number of contacts from the simulation. We already run some ARMA number 3 gradation, and as you see, there are this is the ARMA number 3 gradation requirement is 95% to 100% passing through 50 millimeter. I assume for now this is 100%. I am gonna later do the 95%, and there is a 35% to 70% requirement passing for 38 millimeter. I generated gradation passing as 35, 50, 60, 70%, and also there is a requirement of 25 millimeter passing, which is 0 to 15%. I also generated passing as from 0 to 15 as 35% passing from, for example, 35% passing from 38 millimeter and 5% passing from 25 millimeter. And for now, I just say there is no particle passing through 12.5 millimeter. And this is our number of contact results we obtained. If you look at the 38 millimeter passing through, you see the increase. But for the 25 millimeter passing, we are not seeing an increase or decrease. I mean, the results are not stable, especially for this 70% one. It is something like that, right? So why this is happening? For now, we don't have a question because those are fresh. But the good thing is, right now I am happy with that result. Right now I am not just saying use smaller particles and you will have more contact points. Basically, in future we can justify that with the structure created in aggregates. And this is the porosity we obtained. I mean, they start around 42%, go down to 40%, but it is almost equal. And this is their comparison. With that, I like to thank you all for listening. I like to thanks to BASF for supporting that project. I like to especially thank Professor Stark for letting us use his direct shear machine. I like to thank all undergrad students help me. I like special thanks James and Mike in this room. So thank you all. That's it. Any questions?
Why three person of that material you used? Why not more? What basis you from that time?
Why three person? You mean that, right?
Yeah.
We used 2.5% for just pouring it over. And it was enough to just connect the points. And we had some samples showing that in with using 2%, we are having some particles that getting apart, not being covered a lot. With using 3%, we can all cover all the surfaces of the aggregates and also the supply enough contact point. This is the optimum value we are getting. That's why we are not using more than 3%. And I should say, since the drainage is very important for us, right now this material is not clogging the any voids. It is just putting a thin surface on the granite or limestone that you use and contact them between points. But if you overuse that material, you might get some leakage in that unnecessary clogging in that places too. Any question? Hassan?
How do you mix this?
How do I mix it?
I mean, you don't pour the material over the compacted rock. You actually mix the material.
Yeah, we put the rock, we put the polyurethane in it, and we basically...
Is that how the field... is it the field application to be to mix it and then put it down? Or?
Right now, I cannot say there is a real field application for that.
Oh, what is this for then?
There is an application in Europe that they sprayed it over the ballast. Okay. But they also did this in, where was this demonstration?
Yeah, let me mention about that. Okay, to answer that question, there are two applications with this technology so far, coating aggregate particles individually. One is with new ballast, you're coating by tumbling actually all the ballast particles. Making with 3% is a key you don't want to do over, just with a thin coat that you're coating aggregates and making the contact points to provide that glue so that the whole thing actually, you may have seen some of these samples in the MPF, basically chunks. These are, they become just one mass and then two masses actually after you shear them in the middle, right? So the other application is what we call now is a maintenance application. The idea is we compact and prepare the shear box sample, and after we put the top box and compact it to the top surface, now we're pouring the sample. And this is the idea of already an existing and a fouled ballast out in the field. Now, we know that fouled ballast is going to have lower strength properties and some stability problems and derailment danger or whatever. Now, you want to treat that in the spot. You're going there without doing any kind of work, just pouring this on top and hoping that with enough still pores, it will seep through it and establish at those contact points the chemical bonding as well. That's what we think is more feasible to use at this time, especially in those critical locations like bridge approaches, some special track work locations, turnouts, and places that there's higher loads applied and more critical conditions apply for the ballast, reduce the ballast life in terms of maintenance. So that's the second application.
Did you face in any few samples that the thing that happened in the same ballast, not at the contact points, like that this material is strong enough that the breakage in the same ballast? Did you face that or
I cannot.
Because the breakage happened in the same. Like,
just in aggregate, but not in the bond. Well, during test, no, we did not face that. But we also test, as I said, we also test unbound tests. And during our testing, we are having a popcorn sounds like tick tock, tick tock, tick tock in the machine, which is caused by breakage, right? But in unbound, I mean, in bound condition, which one is breaking first and which one is breaking later, we cannot really go in and look at it. But I can say first the bond is getting break, then later the aggregate is break. The other thing with that material is that I didn't identify in here, I didn't highlight in here is even the aggregate breaks, this material keeps hold them. Because we have a cotton surface, so even it breaks and apart too, there is always some reinforcement of this cotton supplies that keeps particles at a whole material.
Right, we apply the torture test, for example. I think I forgot that. But
Marcus Dersch, who worked on this earlier, before he said, we were running the shear box machine back and forth on the same specimen. And the first run, you get the shear strain numbers, obviously, stress strain curve. But then after that, if you go keep, turn it around 180, go the other direction, another 2-3 inches, and turn it around. So going back and forth 10 times, we did that, just to crush more material and basically foul more material. That's how we try to generate more fouling material to see whether or not there will be a difference in the fouling amounts in the unbound case versus bounded case. Those amounts were much, much smaller. We didn't get as much, less than 10% actually, of the fines generated from the unbound in the case of bounded. So that again proves that less bonding, less fouling potential of the valve. But the big thing that really is interesting as an application to be applied in new ballasts, railroaders like to deal with their ballast as a flexible material for geometry corrections and things. And upfront gluing their ballast, they want to escape from that idea. Whenever they hear it, they don't like it. So that's why I think this application has a lot more potentials, especially in that special track work, pouring over, instantly increasing the strength and that sort of thing. But I think his focus is on basically how the little changes in gradation by the number of contacts is making a difference in those glued contact points. That's what he's going to explore.
Do you have any idea what the modulus is of this material? Strength?
Modulus strength? No, we haven't run a traction test yet. So.
Maybe I misunderstood. You said that this didn't have any cohesion, or did you? I just got confused.
No, I didn't say this doesn't have any cohesion. What I said is there is a cohesion, but there is also a mathematical error that includes in this cohesion intercept we captured in this x-axis from the Markov-Fehler envelope. So what I said, if you look at the linear cohesion, linear Markov-Fehler envelopes, how you are going to identify this cohesion intercepts you capture in the x-axis. I mean, how many of them is an error, or how many of them is the real cohesion intercept?
But you agree that there is some cohesion.
Of course there is cohesion.
Okay, right.
I mean, this is...
Well, actually, why don't you... Can you turn it on again? Someone is projected.
Excuse me? Can we turn it on?
The apparent cohesion he's talking about is actually something because of your linear interpretation of that one column envelope. Well, in the case of the glued, the C cohesion intercept value was over 200-300 psi, so the other one was much lower.
Okay.
So glue's chemical bond is there. And that comes with reduced friction angles in that case because everything is going to, all the strength is going and picked up by cohesion now.
You haven't run an unconfined though.
Pardon?
You haven't done any kind of unconfined then.
We have time to do it. We haven't done it yet.
Over normal pressures, maybe it's hard to do unconfined.
Yeah, but just like an unconfined cylinder.
You mean traction?
No. Well, you could, but you don't have to confine it. Just glue it together. And
yeah. No, we haven't done that. You're right.
I'm just curious as to how strong it is, because my next question would be,
I see.
You know, is this the right material?
If you're targeting a certain strength property, I mean, I'm assuming this is pretty expensive.
It is, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, maybe it still is the right material, but I keep thinking, well, you know, maybe just pour some asphalt down there or...
Actually, interesting you mentioned that. The same company has another patented product now they're marketing called Elastopaint. Actually, low-volume roads, just dirt roads, well, gravel roads, right? Anyway, how can you use that as a like binder? The same thing as, you know, that's how and why we use asphalt, right? How do you glue the gravel road, basically? And I'm trying to get them to actually sponsor one of our test sections, but that's another story.
I guess my only thought is I don't know the answer, is that whether that this is a high-end application, but in the end, the properties you need don't need polyurethane, but just a binder of some, you know, a byproduct binder.
Right. Which could be even blind flash stuff like that.
Yeah, I mean, from my side, I was thinking, why can't we just use a cement slurry and get the same properties? Because to me, the C value isn't extremely high, so we could probably just, although I'm still, I think that the issue with permeability is the problem. You pump everything full.
Now, that's the biggest thing, though. No, I wouldn't agree on that from the point of it, the cementing the material. You're now forming a bond layer, which is hard to have a permeable, you know, layer.
Right.
In this case, you're just coating with a thin coat individual rocks, so the high permeability of the drainage aspect of ballast is still there. Actually, the biggest application they did on this technology before they came to Aeros was the riprap coating. These are large rocks really on the shorelines. All those large rocks are being pulled by the waves, the ocean, you know, pulling them back, and you always lose those on the shores. But gluing them, they found in Europe that a lot of those now resist the actions of the waves. They're not pulled back to the sea, and shores are still open, and they still damp down the wave action because of that porous nature of the riprap on the social shoreline, and yet they are at the contact points at such high strengths glued to each other, you know? They're not taken apart and pulled back into the sea or something. That kind of thing, that's how they brought them into railroad when they contacted us 3-4 years almost. There you go.
This material cost effective, I mean, maybe some early to answer that, but is the cost, is it worth it to have this material and maybe it will give us more service life for the ballast?
Well, it is going to increase the service life, definitely, but the main target of this material, using it for all track or just for special places, like bridge approaches. I mean, it might be cost effective to use it at a bridge approach that you go and try to maintain and raise your track, I mean, frequently than using that material if it is going to improve that cycles, right?
Yeah, that's one of the potential things that we will try, especially in the bridge approaches we are studying in the Northeast Corridor, those Amtrak sites that over the summer actually we spent you probably heard about Deb's presentation talking about installing MDBs. Those same sites, now we're collecting the ground truth information, basically which layers they're forming. And we're seeing ballast movement a lot. Just to arrest the ballast movement, just to keep the ballast in place, gluing it is the option that we're very favorably considering. So that's one of another similar technology has been tried and actually applied in railroads in Germany. They call it Duraflex. And their railroad ballast becomes a chunk like, you know, what we see here too. And even, you know, pulling from the rail, now they get the ties, which are already embedded into the ballast, right? Anything above the subgrade comes up as they pull with the crane. You know, all of a sudden the ballast layer is one big chunk coming out. That's how strong that glue can be, actually. Yet still keeps it open graded. I'm thinking in the pavement application, just to keep the layer open graded and prevent that deterioration, that may be a good option. I don't know, even maybe on the concrete pavements or whatever, where the drainage is needed. So, we should try.
Another question?
Well, thank you, Hussein.
Thank you.